Welcome. Welcome and thank you for coming. We're laying to rest. We're saying our farewells to Lola Maud Mintues Taylor, 93 years old. And we're saying farewell from her children, myself, Susan, Julie, Martin, Miriam, and Anne, and from her grandchildren, great-grandchildren, cousins, our cousins, cousins-in-law, grandcousins. And in a second, I'll just ask the girls, please, Susan, Miriam, and Anne, Julie, to come with me as the six pallbearers bring Mum's body in. So excuse me. Family to bring forth flowers from their garden to put on Mum's coffin. Please sit. Now, Mum has specific instructions on what poetry shall be read, and there will be some poetry read. And Annie B, Annie Beatrice, is here, but I'm not sure. Where are you, Annie? You give it a go. So Annie will come up, just in case we had it actually recorded. There's a poem coming come up from a Shakespearean play, but Annie will tell you about that. Over to you. You stand there, boy.
Do you have a copy of it?
No, I don't. Yeah.
I don't. Yeah, I'll Google it.
Get on the phone. Yeah,
as Grandma would have.
It's plenty of time. From Cymbeline.
So it is a song, not a poem. Can you hear me if I don't use the microphone? But you can all hear me? Good. I was taught to project my voice by Grandma. Intercostal diaphragmatic breathing. I still remember it. So it is actually a song, but I won't be singing it. So I'll say it as a poem from Cymbeline, Shakespeare. And it is supposed to be happy. Because the point of it is that the dead are lucky because they have nothing to fear anymore, whereas, you know, the rest of us do. So that's the idea behind it. Fear no more the heat of the sun, nor the furious winter's rages. Thou thy worldly task hast done, home art gone, and taken thy wages. Golden lads and girls all must, as chimney sweepers, come to dust. Fear no more the frown of the great, thou art past the tyrant's stroke. Care no more to clothe and eat, to thee the reed is as the oak. The sceptre, learning, physic, must all follow this and come to dust. Fear no more the lightning flash, nor the all-dreaded thunderstone. Fear not slander, censure rash, thou hast finished joy and moan. All lovers young, all lovers must consign to thee and come to dust. No exercise or harm thee, nor no witchcraft charm thee. Ghost unlaid forbear thee, nothing ill come near thee. Quiet consummation have, and renowned be thy grave.
Thank you, Annie. Credit to your grandmother. Now, Mum has said that she wants to deliver her own eulogy, so she will be. So we'll skip Mel, that, thank you, and we'll go straight now to my mother's farewell to us all. Thank you, Mel.
I have lived a very long and interesting life, so I hope this won't take as long as I've lived. I have many people to thank, including my eldest son John, who has arranged my funeral to my approval. I want to thank my darling daughter Anne for the years of devotion and love she has shown me, particularly during these last days of my life. In the many years we have lived together, not a harsh word has passed her lips, and not a day has gone by without her loving care. Thank you, my darling. Grateful thanks to dearest Sue for the meals, phone calls to manage my care and comfort, and the continual concerned visits to me to comfort my fears. Thanks to Bob for making me argue and laugh at the same time. Dearest Miriam, for the daily phone calls of love, care, in spite of the busy life managing with her nan, her husband, and many businesses. Loving thoughts to my son Marty and his daughter Rosella, whose exploits delight me, and his visits me weekly. Also to my daughter Julie, who has been discovering my family secrets and revealing the history of my ancestors, of whom I knew so very little. To my dearest friend Kath, whose weekly visits and lively conversation have lightened my life. Thank you very much, Kath. I guess you all, my family, know of my strange and varied life, how at almost 2 years my lovely father died. The depression years forced my mother to enter work. There was no widow's pension then. So I spent from 5 to 8 years in the Queen Alexandra home. Lots of kids to play with, no bad times, expect catching every known contagious disease at the time. So I came home to a little flat in the valley because my mother said, you're old enough to look after yourself now. And my mother worked at the newspaper Truth. I remember those huge presses, and later Mum worked managing the jobbing department. I spent most nights waiting there for Mum. I met the man of this department, and I can still remember it all more quite clearly. It was a very unusual department, but I seem to have had some printer's ink somewhere in my blood, I think. My schooling was strangely held at the state school for girls, which was most unusual at the time. All women teachers and a headmistress, Mrs. Ferguson. And we also had Miss McDonald, who played the piano, and Miss Ulrich, who taught us graceful dancing and sometimes quite exotic and energetic dances. Sad to relate, I didn't pass scholarship, even with an English of 93%. So on to State Full Commercial High. I became a prefect there, you'll never believe it, but I did. As work was always on Mum's mind, at 15 I applied for many jobs, and many I liked and Mum didn't like. So I then found that I ended up in heaven, which was Players Exotic and very influential sportswear pavilion. And it was a beautiful store, beautiful, full of taste and elegance, and run by a very elegant woman. It was a very prestigious place. And I became not only a sales girl, but also a window dresser. 15 shillings a week was my money then. Then the war, World War II. At 16, I left Players and went to work for the US Army Post Office. Most of my friends were at war work, so I thought I should do my bit too. So I decided to work for the Americans. It wasn't hard work, it was just working at V-mail. I won't explain that to you, but it was a very unusual way the Americans had of sending their letters home, by photographing the letters of the boys that were writing them from the front, and then the capsule of film was sent to their parents and developed over there in America. And the same thing happened with their letters. They were developed in America and sent by capsule and developed here into little tiny letters which were sent to the boys at the front. Had a marvellous time. Most of my nights were spent dancing and jitterbugging at the City Hall or at the American PX. Rules were very strong at the PX. You had to dance with whoever asked you. You weren't allowed to drink or smoke, and it was very particularly done there. But I enjoyed that very much, enjoyed mad, wild times. They were wild times. War was over, but dancing continued, where I met your father, the love of my life. The rest is day, babies, nappies, busy moving from place to place, homes at Cooperoo, then at Tingalpa. Hard work, but busy life, helping to build two colleges for my lovely girls and boys. I began to teach class drama at Mount Carmel College in an honorary position. I wasn't paid for 8 years until one nun decided I should be paid. I taught there for 14 years. At the same time I was studying and graduating in 1982 with my ASDA, as Australian Speech and Drama Teacher. I graduated for that. I had moved with Miriam Ann to a little cottage in Stannard Road by this time. I took up pottery, selling at the markets at Riverside and Capalabar, as well as private speech and drama lessons. I loved my garden, but you may thank Miriam for planting all those enormous trees in my garden up the back, giving me so many much trouble and so much trouble for Anne to rake up all the leaves, over 20 bags or more, and counting, I'm sure. She worked so hard. I retired from teaching after various illnesses and subsequent surgeries. One of the great joys which kept my mind updated was a gift from my darling granddaughter, Annie, Beatrice, Lola, and her husband, Tino, my iPad, on which I type my last words to you. Annie and Tino have always been my constant correspondence, always sending me delicious things to tempt my appetite, my loved ones indeed. So now I say goodbye to you all, my friends, my loving and friended children, my 10 grandchildren, my 17 great-grandchildren, knowing I love and am so proud of you all. Bye.
Martin, would you like to come up now?
Well, again, we couldn't give Mum the last word, I'm afraid. The last word actually goes to our sister Anne, who wrote this poem 34 years ago for our Nana, Mum's mum, when she passed away. And of course, Mum wanted this also. A quiet night softly lifted you from life, stole all the memories of a long, full existence. Now to lie like the virgin roses of your wisdom. Do good, be good, fear nothing, make the best of life. But you are woven into our lives, alive in our hearts, in our memories, in our characters, and in our futures.
Alive in 3 generations of grateful children.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Martin. Thank you, Anne. Now, we're getting very close to the end of this. I just want to briefly talk with Susan and Miriam to see if there's anything I've missed before we close. You okay? Okay. Now, Mum had a famous piece of music. It's called the Intermezzo from Cavalleria Rusticana. And it was her mother's favourite piece of music too. And we'll bid our last farewell to Lola, to that music. So I'm not sure whether we stand or sit through this. What do you think? Stand, please. Please, if you'd stand. Thank you, Mel. Thank you for coming. Very shortly, I think Paul will come in to escort the family out, and you might care to follow them over to the hospitality area, to which you are welcome. Thank you, Paul.